Hey guys, and welcome back to my channel for another midweek mystery video, where today we're going to be talking about a possible unsolved serial killer case. The Colonial Parkway murders, which claimed 8 victims between October 1986 and September 1989, are all widely considered to have been committed by the same person, although there is a matter of contention for some. 3 pairs were murdered and 1 pair is still missing to this day, presumed dead. The Colonial Parkway is a 23-mile long scenic roadway running through the state of Virginia in the USA. It links the 3 points what is often referred to as Virginia's Historic Triangle, and every single year millions of people travel down this road. For some, it's just their local road connecting them to their loved ones and their work, whilst others travel down specifically to drive this road and appreciate the natural beauty of Virginia. The parkway was completed in 1957, specifically designed to allow people to appreciate the landscape whilst providing a functional road with little impact on the resources and maximum safety for drivers. They wanted to be able to conserve the scenery and nature as much as possible, and the road is fully maintained by the National Park Service. It doesn't intersect with any other roads, and the parkway was literally just designed to be beautiful and peaceful, which makes what happened there in the 80s so much darker. Our story begins with 21-year-old Rebecca Andowski and 27-year-old Kathleen Marion Thomas. Their bodies were found by a jogger on October 12, 1986, at the Cheatham Annex Overlook along the Colonial Parkway in Williamsburg. Despite many newspaper reports at the time describing them as just really good friends, they were in fact a couple. Rebecca, or Becky as she was often called, was from Poughkeepsie in New York. She'd spent 2 of her teenage years in Paris in France, meaning that she spoke fluent French, and she'd recently transferred to the College of William Mary in Williamsburg, Virginia, where she was a business major. Before transferring, she'd been at Dixon College in Pennsylvania, where she'd been an all-star softball player. Whilst in Williamsburg, Becky had worked briefly at a childcare centre as a teacher's aide for 2-year-olds, where her boss described her as a very dependable, very reliable person. She was a real sweet girl. Everybody here liked her. Kathleen, or Kathy to friends and family, was a few years older than Becky, and she had already done quite a lot with her life. She had graduated from the US Naval Academy in the 2nd ever class allowed women. And whilst this was an incredible feat, it made her career pretty difficult. Even though the Navy were now allowing women, it wasn't like it was suddenly easy to be a woman in the Navy. She faced a lot of challenges along the way. And on top of this, she was a gay woman in the Navy at a time when it was not okay to be so. She served as a protocol officer at the US Atlantic Fleet headquarters in Norfolk for a while, but she was eventually discharged, and her sexuality is considered to be one of the reasons for this. So instead, in the June of 1986, Kathy starts work as a stockbroker at Broker Securities, at which she was pretty successful in the short time she was there. Kathy and Becky had been introduced by Kathy's former girlfriend, which is just the most wonderfully lesbian scenario, and they were still in the early stages of their relationship in the October. I think they'd been dating for around 6 months. Becky was in her last week of school before it ended for the fall break, and she was expected to go home to New York after classes ended on Friday. But of course, she never did arrive home. Her family didn't immediately report her as missing when she didn't arrive home on the Friday, because she didn't actually tell anyone a specific day or time she'd be home. She just told her sister that she intended to arrive home in Poughkeepsie at some point in the break, and they thought that she might stop to see friends in Washington DC or at her old Dixon campus. So when she hadn't arrived home by Sunday, nobody was really that concerned. Kathy and Becky were last seen together on the William & Mary campus on Thursday night, October 9th, where they were helping a friend with some homework. And nobody really knows what they did after that, but it's thought that whoever murdered them likely did so that very same night. It's thought that Kathy didn't show up for work on the Friday, and the police later found Becky's car still parked on campus, fully packed and ready for a trip back home. It's thought that after helping their friend with their homework, they headed out in Kathy's car to probably get some food and spend some quality time together before Becky left for Poughkeepsie. Whatever happened over the coming hours is still a mystery. And they wouldn't be found for a number of days, until a jogger came across Kathy's car, a white Honda Civic, around 5:30 p.m. on the Sunday. It was found about 8 to 10 feet deep in the briars and brambles down an embankment at the edge of the York River, about a 15-foot drop from the road, the Colonial Parkway. The car had come off the westbound side of the road near the 9-kilometre mark, and it wasn't visible from the road. It was found near a scenic overlook for the Cheetham Annex, about 10 miles from the college and 6 miles from Yorktown. The jogger informed the park rangers of what he'd found, who just assumed the car had crashed over the embankment. So they smashed the back windows to try and help whoever was in there, but what they found inside was clearly not the result of a crashed car. It was much darker than that, and the park rangers called the FBI in almost immediately, as a parkway is federal land, it's under the FBI's jurisdiction. But Hampton, York County and State Police all assisted with the investigation which was about to ensue. Two bodies were found inside the car, Becky and Kathy. Becky was found laying in the back seat and Kathy was underneath the hatchback. As somebody who knows literally nothing about cars, I didn't even know what a hatchback is, so I've googled it, and I think essentially she was found in what would be the boot of her own car. Both of them were found fully clothed but obviously dead, with their throat slashed ear to ear. There was blood everywhere, and it didn't take long for investigators to come to the conclusion that the motive for this murder was not sexual in nature or robbery. Both women were fully clothed with no outward signs of sexual abuse, and nothing had been stolen as far as they could tell. Money remained in their bags and their wallets were still in the car completely untouched. Weirdly though, the entire interior of the car and the two bodies had been doused in diesel but not burned. It seems that whoever murdered Kathy and Becky intended to burn the bodies and the scene of the crime, but didn't realise that diesel fuel is much less flammable than petrol. If you toss a lit match into a puddle of diesel, it will just go out. It takes intense pressure or a very sustained flame to ignite diesel. Whoever the culprit was, they clearly didn't realise this and hadn't attempted it before. There were used matches on the ground that showed the culprit very much did try to set it alight, but was unsuccessful. And the fact that the culprit had diesel on them to make this attempt shows that it was probably premeditated. So instead, the car was partially hidden in the brambles, out of sight of the road. The culprit probably wanted to push it right into the river, but it got stuck and they left it there. The autopsy took a while to come in, but the results were brutal. It turns out that the slashes across their throats had not been the cause of their deaths. There had been a struggle, and it seemed that Kathy in particular had put up a hell of a fight. She had a knife cut at the base of her thumb and both of them were covered in bruises. Once the killer had regained control, Kathy and Becky were tied up and strangled with a nylon line, the type that is commonly used by boaters. Small pieces of it had been found in Kathy's hair, even though the killer had gone to the effort of removing it. And it was only then that the killer slashed their throats ear to ear and put them in the car and took it to where it was found, pushing it off the road. And whilst there was a sign of struggle on the bodies, there was no sign of a struggle in the car or in the surrounding area, leading to the conclusion that they had been attacked and killed elsewhere. It was concluded that the killer was highly likely to be male because of the physical strength required to carry out an attack like this. Even though Kathy was a trained naval officer and would have been pretty strong herself, she was overpowered. And the autopsy confirmed what investigators thought. There was no sign of sexual assault. The murder brought up a lot of questions. Why were Kathy and Becky targeted specifically? Was it a homophobic attack? Was it random? Had they been followed? The FBI spent a lot of time trying to piece together the last movements of the couple. They know they went for dinner as there was food in their stomachs, but no one knows where or at what time. They were likely attacked on their way back from dinner, but were they on their way home at this point or were they headed elsewhere? Had they potentially got out of the car at location for a walk? And the motive behind this murder was a complete and utter mystery. The police did look at people close to the women as potential suspects in this. Kathy's former girlfriend was even considered a suspect for a while, but was eventually ruled out. Neither of them had any big enemies or arguments in their life, no one who would openly want to hurt them. All leads fizzled out and eventually the case just went cold. Everyone assumed it to be a one-off murder, likely somebody with a personal vendetta or a homophobe angered at the sight of two women together. There wouldn't be another parkway attack for almost another year. 20-year-old David Nobling and 14-year-old Robin Edwards were shot and killed in the Ragged Island Wildlife Refuge on the south shore of the James River near Smithfield, Virginia, on the 20th September 1987. Similar to Kathy and Becky's case, we don't know loads about David and Robin's movement on the night they died, but we do know enough. We do know that on the 19th, David offered to drive his younger brother Michael, younger cousin Jason, and Jason's 14-year-old date Robin Edwards to the cinema to see a movie. Only when they got to the cinema, the movie was sold out, so they decided to go to a local arcade instead. It was raining when they left, so Michael and Jason said they would ride in the back of David's Ford Ranger pickup truck to save Robin getting wet. It was about a 20-minute drive home from here, and this was about the only time all night that David and Robin spent alone together. But it was clearly long enough for the two to arrange a secret rendezvous for later that night. Robin was dropped home and called her mum just before her curfew at 11 p.m. to let her know that she'd arrived home safe, and David dropped his cousin off before heading home himself. It's thought that he then left the house later that night, probably after midnight, to go and pick Robin up again. I'm going to address the age gap thing here before I get too deep into this part of the story because I know I'll get a lot of comments about it. David was 20, although some sources do say 19. Regardless, he was a full-grown adult, and Robin was a 14-year-old 8th grader at Huntington Middle School. Perhaps the two met up again later that night just as friends, but I think the general consensus is that they met up for less PG reasons, even though neither family knows whose idea it was or why they decided to meet up again. It's noted that Robin did tend to be attracted to older boys, but I couldn't really find anything on David's usual type, although it does seem he had recently learned that his girlfriend was pregnant. This age gap, 20-14, is not okay today and was even not okay by the standards of the 80s, but it probably still does not justify the brutal murder of both of them, which would happen just a number of hours later. I don't think the killer's main concern was the age gap between these two. Had Robin and David not been the victims here, it likely would have just been another couple, another night. They were most likely just in the wrong place at the wrong time. And there is, of course, possibility that they didn't meet up at all for sexual reasons. It's all just complete speculation and nobody has any answers here. Some think they might have met up to buy drugs and the whole thing might have been a drug deal gone wrong, even though neither of them had any known links or usage of drugs. Or maybe they just wanted to go for a friendly platonic walk. The point is, nobody knows why they met up, which just adds another layer of mystery to this. From what I can gather from comments on Facebook from people who knew Robin, it seems that she was a bit of a free spirit, perhaps a slightly troubled girl going through puberty. She was having a bit of teenage rebellion, it seems, and she'd recently become involved in peer counselling after being diagnosed with depression, and she had run away from home a couple of times before, usually heading to a friend's house just a few blocks away. So when the next morning her family discovered she wasn't home, it wasn't a huge concern for them. I think they were concerned, of course, but sometimes she just did this. She just disappeared and she had to come home again eventually. She always came home again, and she was showing that she was improving. Even her grades at school had begun to get better. So she'd been in a very bad place, and now she seemed to be on the up again. But there was no sign of David the next day either. But again, I don't think his family was too concerned. He was an adult, and it was a weekend, and he had a pregnant girlfriend. He was more than happy to go out and do whatever he wanted. He'd recently begun working as a salesman for water purification systems, and he was on the road to becoming a proper adult with this and his pregnant girlfriend. It was early Monday morning though when a sheriff's deputy spotted David's 1986 Ford Ranger pickup truck in the car park of the Ragged Island Wildlife Refuge. It was found at the southern end of the James River Bridge. The keys were still in the ignition, the wipers were still going, and the radio was still playing. There were clothes strewn about the cab of the truck, as well as a wallet in full view on the front seat. The deputy just turned the ignition off and went on his way, because remember, by this point, no one had been reported as missing. That wouldn't be until later the very same day when the Edwards family finally went to the police. The connection to David also being missing was made, and then the connection to the truck. David was incredibly attached to his truck. It was his absolute pride and joy. Michael Nobling, David's brother, later recalled to the Daily Press, "It was brutal when they found David's truck. We knew something was wrong. He would not leave it there. That was an immediate fact. It was pure hell. I don't remember distinct feelings, just hell." Searches were soon organised within the area, specifically within the wildlife refuge. Inside the car, they found underwear, including a bra. There was a pair of women's shoes, which Robin's mother later identified as hers. And this was the first confirmation that Robin and David had definitely been together when they disappeared. Ragged Island was considered to be kind of a rough place, perhaps even still is considered to be a rough place. Whilst researching, I got the impression that it was known in the local area as a bit of a hookup spot, which is perhaps another reason why the general consensus is that the two snuck out with romantic intentions. Over the next couple of days, the search intensified and local Wavy TV went along with Carl Nobling, David's dad, to Ragged Island to document the search for his son. It showed him poking a stick in the water, trying to find something that would lead him to David. It wasn't long after this when the camera crew were at a local gas station or convenience store when a jogger came rushing in, saying he'd been running on the beach at Ragged Island and had discovered a woman's body lying face down on the shore. The jogger said he didn't get too close to the body because he didn't want to disturb a crime scene. Instead, he came straight to the store to notify the police. The jogger returned back to the island with Wavy TV following, which is where they discovered Carl with investigators heading back down to the island himself. The jogger went with this new search crew to show them what he'd found. Sadly, it was Carl who found David's body just a few dozen yards away from Robin's at the base of the embankment. He later said that they, law enforcement, didn't want me to go down there, but I told the deputy I'm going anyway. I didn't recognise the girl because I'd never seen her before. We kept walking, looking for something down there, and me and one of the detectives found David 50 feet farther down, I guess. The discovery of the bodies was announced on local TV before the families were even notified. Robin's mother and sister found out this way, as did David's brother. After a bit of back and forth, it was decided that the Virginia State Police would handle this investigation rather than the FBI, who were handling Kathy and Becky's case. The autopsy showed that both had died via a single shot in the head, execution style, from the back. David had an extra gunshot wound in his shoulder as well, which they believed he received whilst he was trying to escape. The killer shot him in the shoulder as he was running, and when David dropped to the ground, he was shot in the head. Robin was wearing a blouse and her trousers when she was discovered, and David was just in his trousers. And whilst David's wallet remained in the car, Robin's wallet was missing. But they're not convinced it was stolen by the killer. It easily could have been washed away in the river. And speaking of the river, it's thought that David and Robin's bodies were probably in the water for a period of time, perhaps even for 3 full days. There's a possibility that the bodies were pulled by somebody several hundred feet into the river, because it's only a few feet deep until about 300 yards in. So it is possible that somebody could have dragged them in there. They were later washed up by the tide, which is where they were found. They likely weren't just lying on the shore unfound for days. They were a mile or so from where David's truck had been found, probably a 10-15 minute walk at most. Did they leave the truck of their own free will and walk down there themselves, which is where they came across their killer? Or did the killer come across them in the truck and force them to walk down to the river, probably at gunpoint? It's been theorised for years that the scene with the truck was entirely staged by the killer. The keys were in the ignition and turned on to the accessory mode, meaning that the radio could play. Only David had personalised his truck, it was his pride and joy like I said, and he'd wired the radio in such a way that it could be turned on without having to have the keys in the ignition. And David always reverse parked or parked with the front facing outwards, and that is not how the truck was found. And there's argument that the underwear in the cab appeared to be laid out neatly, not as if it had just been ripped off in the heat of the moment. Was the killer just trying to mess with the police, or did they leave the keys in the ignition with the radio on, hoping to draw somebody's attention, hoping that somebody would steal the truck in this fairly rough area and deal with it for them? If the killer was familiar with this area, they might have incorrectly assumed that it would be quickly stolen. And as David's family stress, it's highly unlikely that he would have left the keys in the ignition just to go for a walk. That truck was his life. He wouldn't have just left it so easily stolen. The investigation in general around this seems to have been pretty poor. It had rained a couple of times in the time that David and Robin were missing, so any clues or footprints in the area would have been washed away. Police photographed the truck at the scene, but actually allowed Carl to drive it home and waited several days before searching it for fingerprints, which by that point would have been pretty much redundant. Apparently they wanted to wait for the truck to dry out before looking for any prints. And the police barely put any effort into searching the area until Robin's body was reported, with Carl doing most of the searching himself. It's probably worth noting at this point that a lot of the information I'm talking about in this video actually comes from the blog of a man called Blaine Pardoe, who is a best-selling true crime author who happens to be very knowledgeable about the Colonial Parkway murders. He actually wrote a book called A Special Kind of Evil, The Colonial Parkway Serial Killer, which he released in 2017. This guy really knows what he's talking about, and therefore I'm inclined to trust the words of his blog. I'll leave the blog link to my sources down below in case you want to go for a really deep dive into this. After the murder, there was plenty of speculation about death threats that had been reportedly been made to David in the days before his death. The police followed through on this because obviously that's pretty important, and found them to be nothing serious though. All there has been in this case is speculation, never any facts, never any answers, even with a $5,000 reward being offered. At the time, there were no connections made to Kathy and Becky's murder the year before, and to this day, state police investigator Danny Plott remains unconvinced that the killings in Ragged Island were connected to the rest. There's no denying the manner of death here. Single execution-style gunshot wounds is very different from strangulation and throats being slit. But two couples being murdered, isn't that too much of a coincidence? They were 11 months and 30 miles apart though, being looked at by two different sets of investigators. Kathy and Becky were being dealt with by the FBI and David Robin by the Virginia State Police. There would be no link made at all until a third set of murders happened the very next spring. On April 10th, 1988, 18-year-old Cassandra Lee Haley, known as Sandra or Sandy, and 20-year-old Richard Keith Cole, who usually went by his middle name, both students at Christopher Newport University, were reported as missing. The two had gone on their first date the night before on the 9th of April, with Keith picking Sandy up from her home. She had a 2 a.m. curfew and he promised her parents they would be back in time as they were only going to the cinema. Now, I'm not too sure whether or not this ended up happening, but what I do know is they did end up going to an off-campus party together, which they left at around 1:45 a.m. in Keith's car. I'm sure he intended to get Sandy home in time for a curfew, even though attendees at the party say that the two barely hung out with each other all night. They didn't even do so much as hold hands at the party, but he still wanted to get her home in time. Keith had been in a long-term relationship for years, which had recently ended. So when the opportunity for a date with Sandy arose, he didn't want to say no, but he wasn't looking for something serious. This wasn't a burning, passionate love between the two of them. I'm sure Keith wasn't that interested in a new relationship already, and they were university students, they just wanted to have fun. I'm sure when they got to the party and saw people they knew, they naturally got drawn apart. And I think it says a lot about both their natures that they still left together to head home safe. This would have been the last time either of them would be seen alive, neither of them would arrive home. It was the next morning when Keith's car was found on the York River overlook by the Colonial Parkway, not far north of Yorktown, and it was only barely a mile southeast of where Kathy and Becky had been found a couple of years before. Keith drove a red 1982 Toyota Celica, which just so happened to be spotted by his very own father, Richard Cole, whilst he was on his way to work the next day. Concerned, Richard decided to stop and check the car out, but he didn't see anything suspicious and Keith was 20 years old. Whilst Richard probably knew that Keith hadn't come home the night before, he didn't seem too concerned. He was probably just a uni student out there living his best life. Richard just assumed that Keith had left the car at the overlook to get a lift somewhere with friends or to go for a walk with his date. It is worth noting though that this is not the kind of place you would park if you wanted privacy with somebody. I mean, Richard clearly spotted the car, clear as day, when he was driving over the parkway that morning. So it's not like Keith had hidden the car away to sort of make out with Sandy a bit. That isn't the case here. But just a couple of hours later, by the time a park ranger happened to come across the car, the entire scene had changed. The door was now ajar and the keys were in the ignition, much like the scene at David and Robin's murder. Watches, underwear and several items of clothing were scattered about inside the car, on the seats and on the floor. Although some other sources do state the clothes were neatly folded on one of the back seats, so I'm not sure which is correct there. Sandy's bag was in the car along with Keith's wallet and another wallet containing $12. Sandy's own wallet was missing from her bag though. Richard insists when he saw the car that same morning, only a few of these items were in there. Whilst this seems very strange and mysterious, there may have actually been a rather simple explanation for this. Danny Plott, one of the investigators who worked on David and Robin's case, has stated that the park rangers had actually come across the car first, not long before Richard had. They thought that it was simply an abandoned vehicle, I'm sure that's something that happened a lot around this area, and so the park rangers took a few items from the unlocked car in an attempt to ID the owner. But once they realised that there might be a little bit more going on here than a simple abandonment, they placed the items back and never told anyone else. Hence all of the differences. It seems like it might have taken a while for this to come to light though, which I'm sure did have an effect on the investigation. The FBI were actually so furious about this, because of course the parkway is their jurisdiction, that they actually apparently briefly considered the possibility that the perpetrator was a park ranger, deliberately trying to mess up the scenes to confuse the investigation. And it wasn't of course just the park rangers who seemed to mess up the early investigation here, because once the media heard about what had happened, they descended down upon the scene and as good as destroyed it. Any footprints or tire prints were completely destroyed. Although it does seem that from Blaine Pardo's blog that the York County Sheriff's Department are under the impression that the car was simply dumped on the parkway. The crime scene was somewhere else entirely, somewhere between the party and Sandy's house. From what I can gather, the place where the car was found was not on the route to Sandy's house, and it made no sense for it to be there. Although please take that with a pinch of salt, I'm not 100% sure on that. Despite this train of thought now, early on investigators surmised that the two had actually decided to go skinny dipping on their journey home and they drowned. Now my first concern with this theory is that it seems that the two left the party when they did to ensure Sandy got home in time for a curfew. Why would they suddenly decide to miss the curfew for a spontaneous spot of skinny dipping in April? It was too cold for swimming, and according to her sister, Sandy wasn't a fan of swimming in general, saying, "My sister and I are the same. If we can't see the bottom, we're not going in." And Keith's family agreed too that this was unlikely. The US Coast Guard searched the water and the shore between the Colman Bridge and the Yorktown Naval Weapons Station in line with this skinny dipping theory. And dogs did seem to follow their scent down the road to a beach along the York River, which I'm sure just solidified the theory in their minds. A woman even came forward telling authorities that she'd seen a head in the water while she was boating, but the search was called off just 12 hours later, with the woman admitting that it could have been debris or another object. By April 12th, the FBI was treating this though as an abduction. As I said, as with Becky and Kathy's case, this happened under federal jurisdiction and therefore the case belonged to the FBI. It was after this disappearance that the connections began to be made between the three cases. Becky and Kathy because it was so close and David and Robin because of the very similar circumstances surrounding the car. This was the first time that anyone had an idea that there might be a serial killer on the loose, prowling the parkway. In May 1988, an FBI special agent acknowledged the possibility that they could all be linked, but said there was no actual proof. Nothing other than speculation and geography. Was there a serial killer who was specifically looking for romantic couples at remote locations? A killer who knew the area well, knew the right areas to look in? We could argue that if it didn't seem that Kathy's car had literally been pushed off the middle of the road and the other two seemed to be completely staged. We can't operate under the assumption that the crimes, the murders, happened where the cars were found. But if that is the case, whoever the perpetrator was here, they were incredibly careful. They knew how to set the scene, they knew what they had to do to remain undetected. An interesting thing that was picked up on though was that whilst wallets were never stolen from any of the scenes, robbery was clearly not the motive here, they were always out and visible. What reason would there be for each victim, or at least one of the set of victims at least, to get their wallet out? Perhaps they were approached under the guise of it being a robbery. Perhaps when you're approached, probably at gunpoint, you automatically assume it's going to be a robbery so you can get your wallet out. Or, as seems to be the more common train of thought here, was each couple stopped under the guise of law enforcement? Was somebody driving around in a fake police car or perhaps an undercover style car with sirens pulling people over and then attacking them? Sadly, the bodies of Keith and Sandy have never been uncovered, but it's commonly thought now that they did fall victim to foul play. I think the skinny dipping theory just faded away eventually, especially when the fourth pair fell victim to the Colonial Parkway. It was the 5th of September 1989, over a year and a half later, when 18-year-old Anna Maria Phelps, known as Anna, and 21-year-old Daniel Lauer vanished whilst en route to Virginia Beach. Now, straight off the bat, I want to point out that Anna and Daniel were not a couple. Anna was actually the girlfriend of Daniel's brother, Clinton. Daniel actually lived in Amelia County in Virginia, but had taken the opportunity over Labor Day weekend to go and visit his brother in Virginia Beach, where Clinton and Anna, I think, shared an apartment. At some point over the weekend, the three had had a conversation when it was decided that Daniel was going to move in with them for a bit. But he needed more clothes, so on Sunday night he was going to drive home, grab some stuff, and then head straight back. Anna, thinking this would be a great chance to pop back home and see some family, decided to go with him. Daniel would drop her off on the way and pick her up again when he was heading back. Which is exactly what happened. He picked her up from her parents' house as planned for the drive back to Virginia Beach. It was about 11:15 p.m. by the time they got going for the 2-hour drive back home. But when they hadn't arrived back in Virginia Beach by the next morning, Daniel's mum reported them as missing. Clint had called her that morning to say that Anna and Daniel had never arrived back. And it wasn't long until Daniel's car, a 1973 Chevy Nova, was discovered in the westbound rest area of the I-64, near the Route 155 exit. Now, you may have noticed this was not found along the Colonial Parkway. This case actually wasn't all that close to the parkway at all. This case hasn't been connected to the others due to the location, but more due to the circumstances. Highway workers reported that the car had been there since at least 9 a.m, and a state trooper arrived to have it towed away, but soon realised that the occupants of the car had been reported as missing, so delayed in doing so. At the time, this rest area, which was generally designated for large trucks, had a reputation as being a meeting place for drug deals and hookups. This small car stuck out like a sore thumb, but not just because it wasn't a truck. It was parked very strangely along the side of the ramp, half on the shoulder and half on the road, and very curiously close to a no parking sign. It looked as if somebody had started to drive off the rest stop but had kind of just given up, or it had broken down. But the car was in completely operable condition, with the keys in the ignition just as they had been at the previous two crime scenes, and the tank had plenty of petrol in it. There were no signs of a struggle inside, although strangely, witnesses said that there was a cluster of feathers stuck out of the driver's side window. Although this may have actually been Anna's roach clip hanging from the driver's side window or the rearview mirror. This roach clip did have a feather attached, so people might have got confused. The glove box was also found to be open. The strangest thing about this entire scene though was that Daniel's car was found on the westbound lane of the interstate. To get to Virginia Beach, he would have had to have been driving in the eastbound lane. It was on the complete wrong side of the road for him to have just abandoned it en route. Had somebody else driven it there and abandoned it, or had Daniel turned around for some reason? Once again, there was no sign of either Daniel or Anna, and this time the Virginia State Police took control of the investigation as this crime scene was on the interstate and their jurisdiction. A huge search ensued to look for them, including use of helicopters and dog search teams, but they were unable to pick up scent of either of them. It was just a dead end. Weeks passed with nothing, no sign of Daniel or Anna, until 6 weeks later on October 19th, when hunters found two sets of human remains, virtually skeletonised. They were found in a wooded area off of Route 155, about 3 miles away from where the car had been found, and they were covered with a blanket which had been previously noted as missing from Daniel's car. It was kind of just bad luck they hadn't been found before then. Multiple people had searched this general area, including their own families, but no one ever happened to wander down the abandoned logging road that they were found off of. The bodies were identified via dental records, but the medical examiner found it very difficult to explain how they died. The autopsy was only able to indicate they died within a week of their disappearance. And they actually ended up calling on the Smithsonian for help. Anthropologists at the Natural History Museum are more than used to dealing with bones. This is something that has to be done sometimes, as Smithsonian had the means to conduct more sophisticated tests on the remains and often do have historical skeletons sent to them for analysis. And occasionally they'll receive more recent skeletons as well, such as Daniel and Anna's. It was very difficult to come up with a cause of death here, although it seems that they eventually settled on possible knife wounds due to a cut on one of Anna's fingers, but they don't know that for sure. All they can prove is that Anna probably put up a fight. There's a possibility that they could have been shot, but none of the bones showed any bullet wounds. It was a couple of weeks before Daniel and Anna's bodies were discovered that Larry McCann, an agent with the Criminal Bureau of Criminal Investigation, said that there was a very good chance all four cases were related. The media also started to use the phrase serial killer in relation to the four cases I've outlined in this video, after they got wind of the police suspecting so. I mean, it was kind of the obvious link to make. Each case involved a pair of people travelling by car in fairly isolated areas in the general same place. I found a newspaper article from the time, but I couldn't figure out what paper it was from, nor the date it was published, which isn't very helpful, but if I were to take an educated guess, I would say it was published before October in 1990. This article reads, "Police have been working jointly together for some years now and have come to some possible conclusions," referencing a joint FBI and Virginia State Police task force who are investigating these crimes alongside the local police. It continues with, "The killer may have been dressed as an authority figure such as a police officer to win the victim's cooperation and lure them to their deaths," with the source saying they could not rule out whether the killer was an actual officer or not. Other quotes from a police detective who worked on Kathy and Becky's case and Daniel Lauer's mum said that the police were feeling like everything was connected. Mrs. Lauer said that the FBI and the state police recently told her that they were suspecting a serial killer. The randomness of the crimes and certain similarities does lend credence to the serial killer theory, but it was noted that the crimes lacked a definite signature, because the cause of death tended to be different in each case, which is unusual for a serial killer. But it was decided that investigators would look at the four sets of homicides as though they were connected. They were officially being linked. As we've covered, each pair of victims was likely a couple, apart from Daniel and Anna, who the killer may have mistaken for a couple from afar. Also, there's Kathy and Becky, who are a lesbian couple, but it's thought that the killer may have mistaken Becky's short hair as being that of a man, and they decided to go through with the crime regardless. Is it possible that the killer had a personal vendetta against happy couples? Had the killer possibly gone through a very tough breakup, or were they unable to forge any meaningful connection with the opposite gender? Did their parents have a bad relationship? What are the reasons why somebody could hate couples so much? And the first murder of Kathy and Becky was also different from the rest in that the bodies were found inside the car, whilst the rest of the bodies were found away from their cars, with the exception of Sandy and Keith, whose bodies were never found. Most of the murders happened on or near the Colonial Parkway. The final crime happened on the interstate, but it was close enough to be considered to be linked. It was the same general area, the killer probably just stalked this area looking for potential victims and wasn't that bothered about them being on the parkway itself. It just so happens that two of them happened on the parkway. We've spoken a couple of times about how it's believed that the victims were approached in their cars by authority figures, somebody pretending to be law enforcement. It's the only logical explanation as to why people would stop their cars on such a road. The only other reason I could think I myself would stop at a road was if somebody was hurt or if there was a crash, but something about that doesn't quite make sense with how the wallets were found out at so many of the scenes. In the case of Daniel Lauer's car, the glove box was opened. A lot of people tend to keep their IDs in the glove box. Once the victims have pulled over, they are probably walked away from their cars at gunpoint, which happened in all cases apart from the first. Maybe the killer evolved their technique as time went on, or maybe they were just so furious at realising that Kathy and Becky were both women that they didn't do what they intended to do. I mean, as far as we know, their murder was without a doubt the most brutal, their throats slit from ear to ear. All the couples were fairly young, matching the description of young adult. They were all white. Most of the murders happened around autumn time, with only one taking place in April. In each case, the actual crime scene has not been identified. It saw that each time the killer moved the car after the fact. They were murdered in one place and the cars and bodies were moved to different locations. As you can imagine, this makes it pretty difficult to search for any evidence, as three separate crime scenes for each double murder, only two of them identified in each. Could the third crime scene be the same place for each case? Did the killer just lie in wait in the same place each time they decided to commit murder, just waiting for a couple who fitted his MO to come driving by? Or are there four other entirely different crime scenes out there that have never been identified? But due to the difference in murder weapons in each case, some people think that these murders weren't the work of a serial killer at all, that they just so happened to be committed by separate people. People particularly focus on the case of David and Robin here, as there were other potential suspects in their case, people who knew David in real life. But of course, this has never been proven, just as the serial killer theory has also never been definitively proven. The theory of this not being a case of a serial killer at all was actually brought forward by former Milwaukee homicide detective Stephen Spingola, who looked into the murders on the behalf of the families. He said that Kathy and Becky's murder was a hate crime, that David and Robin were the victims of a robbery, as was Daniel and Anna. A very important piece of evidence came forward in 2010, that there had apparently been a note found in Anna's apartment which contained the name, phone number and the description of car that she was to meet at a rest stop on the night he disappeared. Did Anna intend to stop at that specific rest stop and meet somebody all along? It could explain why the car was on the wrong side of the road. The two had intentionally gone there for some reason or another. But even if this is the case, it still gives no answers as to what actually happened. The Virginia State Police have said that they were aware of the note at the time, but the detective who worked on the case back in 1989 has said that he was entirely unaware of it. So, who knows? But that's a pretty big reason why a lot of people think that Daniel and Anna's case might not be connected at all. It could have been that Anna was going to pick up drugs or something, and something went wrong. The FBI nor the state police have ever released the names of any suspects. In fact, it doesn't seem like they've ever had any really solid suspects. They've had a list, of course, but never anybody that they've been more convinced of than others. A former state police investigator has said that nobody was a suspect and everybody was a suspect. Now, statistically, these cases kind of have to be linked, which is one of the main reasons why people think there is a serial killer. Because Virginia had never seen anything like it before, and have never seen anything like it since. For these four sets of murders to happen independently of one another in the space of just a few years, and then never happen again, is pretty much impossible. They kinda had to be linked, it had to be the same person. If it was more than one person, then it had to be people working in unison, a couple or group of people who colluded to make these murders happen. Which seems even more unlikely than it being just one person, but this is a theory that's been looked into over the years. Could one person have been able to overpower two healthy young people with little signs of struggle at the scenes? Was there potentially a second person who helped control the situation? The case eventually just went quiet. After 1989, there were no more murders, although Virginia waited with bated breath throughout 1990 for the next attack. They just stopped. Perhaps the killer knew that it would be risky to strike again now it was widely acknowledged that all the cases were linked. Perhaps he moved to a new area. Perhaps he continued murdering but under a completely different MO. But despite the formation of the Colonial Parkway Task Force, each case slowly went cold. Maybe they wouldn't have gone cold if this happened nowadays, but back in the 80s, they obviously didn't have the forensic technology that we have today. And the killer covered their tracks as well as they knew how, another reason why people think this could have been a police officer. It wasn't until 2009 that the case came back into the headlines, which led to an eventual renewed search. Graphic photos from some of the crime scenes leaked to the public after a bureau photographer used the photos in a presentation for a civilian security company. Now, these were photos that they never intended for the general public to see, and it was a huge embarrassment for the FBI when they were alerted to the leak by a man called Fred Atwell, who was a former deputy from Gloucester, Virginia. It seems that Atwell tried to warn the FBI about these leaked photos for a long time, but they actually only paid attention when he went to the press about it, so take from that what you will. Atwell discovered that 84 or 78, depending on the source, photos had been leaked. And this did lead to a new interest in the Colonial Parkway murders, which a lot of people had never even heard of in a time before the internet. The leak of these photos gave the families of victims the leverage they needed to pressure the FBI to put in new resources into the cold case. And due to all this renewed media interest, plans were made to re-examine old evidence using modern technology. But this was 11 years ago, and honestly, there doesn't seem to be anything new to report on since then. In 2016, the Daily Press spoke to the FBI, where a spokeswoman said that the investigation was not just open, but active and sensitive at this time. And families of the victims have said that investigators from the FBI or the state police regularly touch base with them to let them know where they're at, and the investigation is ongoing. So it seems that the authorities haven't given up on trying to give them their answers, but the answers don't seem to be getting any closer now than they were 30 years ago. Whilst the FBI and state police looked into the murders, the families of the victims all did the same. They all joined together to do as much investigating as they could themselves and to just support each other in such a hard time. When Fred Atwell blew the whistle on these photos being leaked, he became somewhat of a hero amongst these families, who thanked him for getting the FBI to do some new investigating. But apparently over time, Fred began to act strange, always trying to insert himself into the investigation and into the families. He would spin these crazy elaborate tales, with Kathy's brother Bill Thomas saying to the Huffington Post in 2011, "Last January he, Atwell, called me and said that he'd been contacted by an attorney outside the country who claimed to have a client who was involved in the murders. He said they wanted $20,000 to reveal the locations where Keith and Cassandra's body could be found. The tale got more fantastic as it went on. We were very sceptical, and at some point in the spring, he just dropped it." Atwell was apparently desperate to be involved. He would contact the families on a daily basis. And then in 2011, it took a very strange twist when he was arrested for obtaining money under false pretenses. He claimed he was raffling off a car to raise money for the families, but that's not what he was doing. The families never got any money from him from this weird raffle. Atwell was sentenced to 2 years and 8 months for this, with another 7 years and 4 months suspended. But he also had unrelated charges in other counties, which extended his incarceration at the Deep Meadow Correctional Centre. He ended up staying in prison for years and died in 2018 at a medical facility. And the families of the victims had mixed emotions about this, because whilst he was definitely a very strange man who inserted himself into their lives in a very odd way, every time he did something crazy, he would bring the Colonial Parkway murders to the forefront of the news and put more pressure on the FBI, so it was kind of a double-sided coin. It seems at one point, Atwell even revealed himself to be a suspect, saying that his name was on the FBI's list of 130 possible suspects. He said, "The profile fits me and I am on the list." He apparently angered the FBI when he told the media about the leak of the crime scene photos. And it's odd that he would out himself as being a suspect, but I think he just liked the media attention. I couldn't find anywhere where the FBI themselves said Atwell was a suspect, only that they said Atwell was not in danger of being arrested. Although it would make sense that he would be a suspect, he was in law enforcement and he did show a very unusual interest in the case. To this day, family members of the victims think that he knew a lot more than he ever let on. And of course, there have been other murders linked to the Colonial Parkway murderer as well. There's Julianne Williams and Laura Winans, a couple who went camping in Shenandoah National Park in May 1996. Shenandoah is still in Virginia, it's just about 2 hours away from the Colonial Parkway. They never returned from their trip and their bodies were found near the spot where they were camping on June 1st. 24-year-old Julie was found inside a sleeping bag as if she'd been thrown near the creek. Her throat had been slashed. 26-year-old Laura was still inside the tent, her throat also slashed. Both were almost decapitated, it was so violent. And although both were undressed, there were no signs of sexual assault. This makes me and many other people ask the question, could this and Becky and Kathy's case be exclusively linked? Was their attack a possible violent homophobic attack separate from the rest of the Parkway murders? Maybe, but another one of the murders happened so close to where Becky and Kathy's car was found that this seems kind of unlikely. But could they have possibly been attacked by the same person who attacked Julianne and Laura? Then there's Mike Margaret and Donna Hall from Richmond, Virginia, whose bodies were discovered on August 21st, 1984, after heading out camping for the weekend. Their car, a Jeep, was found on a rural road, half hidden in bushes. The keys were still in the ignition, but blood was on the passenger seat. Their bodies were found laying not far away underneath a blanket. They had been drugged and their throats had been slit, but there was no sign of a struggle or foul play, other than the blood of a third person being found at the crime scene. This blood didn't match either of the victims, and the culprit for this has never been found. Or there's David Metzler and his girlfriend Heidi Childs, who are students at Virginia Tech. They went to the Caldwell Fields on a date in August 2009, yes, 20 years on from the last murders, and they were found dead the next morning in the car park, having been shot multiple times. David was inside the car whilst Heidi was nearby, as if she'd attempted to run away. Where this case differs from the others though is that there does seem to be a prime suspect in this case. I could continue, there are a lot of murders in Virginia around this time that may or may not have been linked. As of today, it doesn't seem that they're any closer to an answer than they were back in 1989. There are still more than 130 suspects in this case, but it doesn't look like they've got the means to definitively prove it was any of them. Back in the 80s, crime scenes were handled very differently as to how they are now. With very limited understanding of forensics and DNA, they weren't as careful with the crime scenes, which generally means that any DNA evidence isn't as well preserved now as it could have been. But apparently, three of the four sets of families have been told by investigators that there's potential DNA evidence in their respective crime scenes. And the families and the first responders at the scenes have been asked to provide DNA samples to eliminate any of their own or the victim's DNA. These cases are not completely impossible, they are solvable. I'm hoping it will be like the Golden State Killer, that quiet work behind the scenes and familial DNA will lead to a match eventually. Even if they can just tell that perpetrator's DNA at the scene is the same in each case, that would be huge. It's amazing how 30 plus years on, these families are still working every single day to try and find justice for their loved ones. Some have given up hope, thinking it will never be solved, and some are convinced it's going to happen one day. And I do have to say, I do think we will get answers in this case. Technology is doing incredible things, and it's only going to get easier. I just really hope that they're going to get justice. The chances are that the perpetrator is still alive, living in the hope that his DNA doesn't catch up to him, and it's probably going to eventually. Thank you so much for watching this video. I'm going to be very intrigued to see what the general consensus is on this case. There's a lot of argument over whether this is a serial killer or not, but I just think that they're too similar to not be linked. There can't be four cases like this happen in the space of 3 years just to never happen again. I just feel like there is too much of a link for it not to be related. But I'm intrigued to see what you guys think. Let me know if there are any other unsolved serial killer cases you would like me to cover on this channel. And thank you for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Bye guys.